You know her, of course, from Caroline in the City. You know her, of course, from Some Kind of Wonderful, from the ABC Family / Freeform Network show, Switched at Birth. You know her from Space Camp. You know her from Power of the Duck. You know her from Back to the Future.
Sometimes it feels like we're getting a little too close to
things.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, that was where they really predicted the future, that red comb over.
So. Yeah. Well, I know.
It's reminiscent of something that's going on right now.
I know it's a story you've told before, but I'm going to ask you to share it again, because I happen to love it. You've mentioned that your sort of favorite incarnation of Lorraine was Biff World, and it's something that is still represented in your reel today, right?
Yeah, I mean, I was only, 25 when I played Lorraine McFly at the old age of 47. And I've always wanted to play that character again, the one that was, you were the one who wanted me to have these things. Back, take them. I want to play that girl. So I keep her on my reel and still, yeah. People keep casting me as little Miss Mary Sunshine. Gosh darn it. I wonder why.
What is sort of the darkest that you've had to go in your work? When have you really been able to plumb that kind of like, that dark side?
Well, not too often, really. I mean, maybe I did cabaret here in Detroit. I did it on tour and then I did it on Broadway. So that was really, for like 8 months, that was a pretty sad part, but you know, in a way I kind of like doing entertainment that is positive, you know, and uplifting. I don't know, I kind of like putting that stuff in the world, so probably that's why I get those kind of parts, because I don't know, it makes me feel so happy when you guys come up to me and say that I, you know, a role helped you get through a hard time or, you know, a sickness, and I don't know, that's just such an immense gift, you know. For me, as a person, to think that I've been helpful. But yeah, maybe, you know, there are dark roles that are still uplifting, so I want one of those.
Yeah. Well, we spoke in 2015 a couple times about the Back to the Future 30th anniversary, and in October there was the lead up to Back to the Future Day, where suddenly you're seeing all these commercials for Pepsi Perfect or for the Nike shoes or all of those things. When you're watching that, what was sort of striking you as the most surreal kind of product that they brought to life? Because even like they had the USA Today cover, that was the front cover from the movie 2015. So what was just sort of the most surreal thing that you encountered?
Well, the most surreal thing is that people still love the movie and then they show it to their kids and their grandkids and their, in the case of my mother-in-law, their great-granddaughter. And for me, when you're making a movie, you don't think that it's gonna end up like that. I mean, even Bob Zemeckis, who's made great, great, great movies, is shocked that he really believes that this is probably the movie that he'll be most known for. And we're all just like, that's what's surreal, that's what's so beautiful, and to live long enough to see that, and is something you you don't think about when you're just, you know, I'm getting clumped. You don't think about that when you're just showing up for your work, you know, and that's a gift.
Yeah.
It really is.
Well, let's go ahead and throw it to a question from the audience. Hi there.
Hi. Hi. We met earlier, and I'm a Switched at Birth fan. There was an episode when I think his name was Lorenzo, and you were in the dancing mode and this and that. Do you ever feel like you want to do that in real life? Just go out and
dance?
Kind of have a moment all to yourself, you know?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Do something whimful.
I do. I think the thing with like mothers and women are like just work, 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 work. So, yeah. I mean, I love that character in Switched at Birth because she, I did the show Switched at Birth for 5 years. And this character was seemed kind of uptight, but she kept trying new things. I think the writers were trying to get me to sing and dance and do all the different things that I do. But I think it was nice because I think it inspired me and maybe people who are watching it to like try new things, keep exploring, keep learning, keep trying scary things. And,
right.
I learned that from the character.
Well, you know, I think like across the board, your work, it's now touching this next generation as well. Like I grew up, I'm part of the Back to the Future generation, but now Switched at Birth is part of this kind of next round. What are you finding a shift in sort of fandom or people that come up to you and talk about your work? Is it still primarily Back to the Future? Is it Space Camp? Is it Caroline the City? Or is it, like, what is it?
I'm just really lucky because I do span a really broad spectrum of things. But what I actually find really weird right now is, like, all of the Howard the Duck fans have come out of the closet. I mean, everybody was so scared. For some reason, I think when they put him in Guardians of the Galaxy, everybody got like not scared to like Howard the Duck, which even me, you know, because everybody who interviews me will always be like they're gonna get me, like, you know, they're gonna bring up Howard the Duck and I'm gonna start to cry. And I'm like, no, I own it, I wear it, I made it, it's cool, and I have the best fans. So that's been the weird thing that's been happening lately is kind of a political correctness about being Howard the Duck fan, which I really enjoy.
I have a fondness for Howard the Duck because, you know, when I watched it as a kid, like, I laughed. Like, it provided me with entertainment, you know? And no, I would not say it's a perfect movie, but, but I have a fondness for it. Do you still have, like, what is sort of the memory that springs to mind when someone mentions Howard the Duck? What is your recollection that you're personally kind of connected to?
I was half naked, strapped to a table for a month. That's what I remember. I was very, very cold. I was just coughing and they would throw a blanket over me in that big last scene with the thing and the thing. I was like, ah! That's what I remember, being very cold. But yeah.
Do you think it made you a better actor, because that's not an easy challenge to be, you know, acting opposite a duck.
Making a duck sexy.
Making a duck
that
sexy.
That requires a special skill set. I actually have 7 ducks right now. White ducks. 6 boy ducks and 1 poor girl duck right now.
Do you know who the father is?
Hi. I'm sure there's tons of stories that you can tell from being on set of the movie, but what's one of your favorite behind-the-scenes moment from the first Back to the Future?
My favorite memory is that I had all this makeup on in the first scene when you meet George and Lorraine, and I have the cake, and I'm like, Uncle Jailbird Joey didn't make parole again. when we did that scene, well, they glue that makeup on your face, and you have to be really careful because it's a long day, and if you lift the makeup off your face, they have to start over and the day's ruined. So we couldn't laugh or make too many expressions, and Crispin Glover kept watching the honeymooners going like this. And we couldn't stop laughing, so I was like this. Trying not to laugh. was a great day, because that was a funny scene, and he was really funny, and I had my Papaw vodka, and I was ready.
Was that application better or worse than the makeup for Back to the Future 2? Had it gotten a little bit easier for you a couple years later?
Well, yes, it got easier for the Back to the Future 2 and 3 because there was another makeup artist. The makeup artist was really mean. So when you have to sit there in someone's space for 3 hours and they're, you know, because it's 3 hours.
Yeah.
You're just sitting there. It's horrible.
Yeah.
If someone's crabby. No good.
Yeah, no fun. Hi there.
Hi. First of all, thanks for coming out and hanging out with all of us this weekend. Appreciate
it. Thank you.
My question is about Back to the Future. I guess it's fairly well known that you guys started out with Eric Stoltz instead of Michael J. Fox. It's been kind of one of those things that's always sort of fascinated me, that, you know, you filmed this stuff and apparently it wasn't working and then they moved to Michael J. Fox. I guess my question for you is kind of two-layered. One, did you feel that maybe, did you have any, like, on-screen chemistry with him? I mean, because I think you guys filmed a couple scenes together before they scrapped it. And had they gone that direction, Michael J. Fox wasn't available, do you think the film would, I don't think it would have been as much of a success, but would it have had some sort of resonance with fans today if they had gone that route, based on your experiences with it?
Yeah, Eric Stoltz shot for 6 whole weeks. Back to the Future, and I had already done a movie with him called The Wildlife, so we were already really good friends. And but Eric just had this, when you watch the movie, you realize that everyone has this kind of like larger-than-life acting style. Crispin Glover is kind of doing commedia dell'arte, big gestures and things, and he was very, and he did that on purpose. And I was doing a very stylized performance, and Chris Lloyd was like, I gotta go, he was like doing all this exposition in the fastest, biggest way possible. We've gotta get this, and it's gonna go, like really hard, but it was very, very big styles. And Eric Stoltz was trying to do some kind of like method performance, like a real serious actor,
sure.
And it just wasn't right. And then. So when Michael Fox came in, and Michael Fox was kind of doing like a Buster Keaton kind of, every single move he choreographed, he would choreograph everything he did. And I thought it was really crazy when I was watching it. I was like, that is so overplanned, like, oh my God. But to this day, I can see how he was doing like a really old-fashioned 1930s kind of, James Cagney kind of thing, and the double take and the spit take and the fall over and the classics. So he really embedded the movie with this kind of engine that,
sure.
that made it less serious and kept people's minds off of the real darker elements of the story. But they were they're both really good, but yeah, I don't think it would have been as big of a hit with Eric for sure.
Yeah.
Long answer?
Well, what's kind of interesting about that is that it was sort of this well-known open secret for a while, and then with the DVD for the 25th anniversary, I think they finally just started showing they put the footage on that DVD, and it's kind of nice because it's just sort of out in the open now, and you guys can go check it out and get that DVD.
It's really cool.
And check it out.
I mean, Eric Stoltz is super handsome. I mean, he was, and I did a movie, Some Kind of Wonderful, with him afterwards too. He's really good.
He's a great actor.
Yeah.
Hi there.
Hi.
Could someone help this young person with that? There you go.
First of all, I love your work in all the Back to the Futures. I have two questions. One, what was your favorite part in filming any of them, in any of the Back to the Future movies?
My favorite part? I love the whole car scene in Back to the Future 1. Because there was like these incredible plot points that had to be sold with just a look, with just acting, where I had to fall out of love with my son and in love with my future husband. And that whole scene is so, when Crispin like reaches down and I look up at him and I had to sell that I fell in love with him at that one moment. And it's just such a beautifully constructed 3 or 4 minutes of film. That's my favorite part. Thanks.
And what was your favorite Back to the Future movie?
I think Back to the Future 1, I mean, people study it in film school as a perfect script. You know, obviously, a perfect script isn't just written. It was perfected as we were shooting. But Back to the Future 1, I'd say. What great questions.
Thank you very much.
One more question.
Oh, okay.
Who was your favorite actor to work with on the in the movies?
Now that gets tough.
It's not being filmed, is it?
The internet is everywhere.
My favorite actor. Well, it's funny because Chris Lloyd is like my best friend now from the movie because I see him a lot in these things. And but I did like 7 movies with Chris Lloyd and only 1 scene, and that's in Back to the Future 1. I never got to act with him. So I guess at the time, probably Crispin. Crispin Glover was, because we had the most scenes together, and he was so eccentric. Like, unbelievably eccentric. When we had to do the last scene of Back to the Future where we're the couple, the like tennis-playing couple, he had a lot of trouble with that character. So he invited me over to his house, which was painted completely black lacquer, with nothing but a 1930s gynecological table in the middle of the true story. And we, in order to do some character research, we painted a volcano. That's how we came up with 2 fabulous middle-class, middle-aged people. He was so eccentric and such a genius, and I had a lot of fun with him. Yeah. Thank you for your beautiful question.
How was your volcano work?
My mother painted over this volcano. It was such a terrible painting. She was like, I'm going to paint over this.
This video is sponsored by the Crazy Kings of Toys. Check them out for all your toy needs and find out why they are so crazy. Find them at Amazon, eBay, BrickLink, and Facebook. Links are in the description. Toxic Pop has a new Facebook page. Like it to see pictures and keep informed about our upcoming events and videos. A link is in the description. Go to www.facebook.com/toxicpop1.